There we go. There I am. Good to see you all this evening. Let's pray as we begin our service tonight. Heavenly Father, we thank you for another time to be together to worship. I thank you that around the nation and around the world, your people have gathered today to sing your praises. Lord, we know that there's no amount of singing we could ever do that would be enough for the glory that you deserve. You deserve all the praise and all the glory. Pray that you'd help us tonight, Lord, as we sing and as in a little while as I preach, that you would give me the words to say, that you would help our hearts be in line to praise your name as we ought to and to hear from you. Guide and direct all that we do, and may your name be lifted up this evening. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good to have you here tonight. We'd like to start out with number 483 in your handbooks, or up on the screen, Footsteps of Jesus. Let's all stand as we sing. Sweetly, Lord, have we heard thee calling, come, follow me. And we say, where thy footprints falling, lead us to thee. Footprints on Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus wherever they go. Though they lead o'er the cold dark mountain seeking his sheep, or along by Salonian fountain helping the weak. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where they go. If they lead to the temple holy, preaching the word, or in homes of the poor and lonely, serving the Lord. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. Then at last, when on high he sees us, our journey done, we will rest where the steps of Jesus in at his throne. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway glow. We will follow the steps of Jesus where'er they go. Over a few pages, number 484. Higher Ground, number 484. I'm pressing on the upward way. I sanctifying every day. Still praying as I onward fell. Lord, plant my feet on high. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. 485, stand up for Jesus. Number 485.
The ground of life shall be.
If you will, turn with me to Acts chapter 20 this evening. Acts chapter 20. We're going to pick up in where we left off this morning in verse 17. So this morning, we talked about what I believe are some things we can learn from the Apostle Paul, how he was in the about the business of making disciples. What does that look like? How does he view the growing of the Christian faith? And this evening, we're going to pick up from there, and we're going to see as he continues, big picture now, Paul is on his way to Jerusalem. He's now traveled around for quite a bit of his life, and his time of being free is really coming to a close. And so what we're going to see happen here is he's headed toward Jerusalem, and we know the story. When he gets to Jerusalem, there's going to be persecution and imprisonment and lots of trouble, and eventually he'll find himself in Rome, and that's where the book of Acts leaves off, and we know from tradition that he continued in Rome and eventually died there. And so he is, in a great way, finishing the time that he has to be free among the church. Matter of fact, he's going to say tonight to the Ephesians that he knows that he'll never see them again in this life. His time with them is over. So again, what are the types of things that you think Paul would make a big deal about? What are the things that were important to him? And what you're going to see, shouldn't surprise us, is that he was focusing on specifically the leaders, and he had some things to say to them. And it lets us know what ought to be important for us as we help others grow in the Lord. So we're going to pick up in verse 17. Acts chapter 20, verse 17. Now from Miletus he went to Ephesus and called the elders of the church to come to him. And when they came to him, he said to them, "You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews, how I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance toward God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ." What I want to do tonight is remind you what I said this morning. And let's see if we see the same points again. This morning, we said that when Paul traveled, remember we talked about how he left Ephesus and he went around all these different places. He went to Macedonia and then on to Greece, then back to Macedonia, and now he's headed towards Syria. And in all of those places, we saw how important it was that he was talking to people in person. Now what's happening is he comes near the city of Ephesus. Remember, if you back up just a verse, Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus, but even so, he stopped long enough to ask the leaders of Ephesus to come to him. And this is the message that he delivered to them. So it's in person. It was encouraging. Now what's interesting to me is that it was Luke who continued pointed out that Paul was an encourager. Paul himself has a different way of saying it. "I didn't shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable, testifying both to Jews and to Greeks of repentance toward God and of faith in Jesus Christ." And he says that he served God with all humility and with tears. We're going to come to that later, but we're going to see that Paul, even in this section, is encouraging the Ephesian leaders. He's bold. He did not shrink from declaring. He is equipping. He didn't shrink from declaring anything that was profitable. So, which brings us to the next one. He's consistent and thorough. Remember, this morning we're talking about him preaching not to midnight. Midnight is where they stopped for a minute. He preached till dawn, through the night. And there was a seriousness to what he had to say, the thoroughness. And now Paul is talking to the Ephesians, and he's letting them know that what he did was anything that was profitable, he did not hold from declaring it to you. And hardworking, we see that in tears and with trials. And then Christ-centered, even in as he's telling them about his time in there, from the time I set foot in Asia, what was he doing? Testifying. both to the Jews and to Greeks, of what? Of repentance toward God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. The way I said it this morning is his teaching was Christ-centered, and now we see again that he's saying there has not been any time that I've been in Asia that my focus has not been toward pushing you toward God and specifically to Christ. Again, this in some ways is his farewell sermon. And what he has to say is, you guys can testify about me. I have done everything that I can to push you toward Christ. I have not stopped declaring to you the things that are important, and I have continued to declare that salvation comes from repentance and of faith in Christ Jesus. Moving on to verse 22. And now behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. But I do not count my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course in the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. And now behold, I know that none of you among whom I have gone out proclaiming the kingdom will see my face again. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Strong words. The first thing he has to say here is that he is still being obedient to the Spirit. You remember how when it was time for him to leave, you remember In chapter 19, we find him in Ephesus. Actually, it was in chapter 18. We find him in Corinth, and then in Antioch, and then in Ephesus. And everywhere he goes, the strange thing about Paul is he stays when everyone else would have leave, and then he leaves when it sure seems hard, and it seems like I would want to stay. As soon as the church is doing well, he's good, and he moves on. And we find out why, because so often as it talks about Paul moving, the way it says is he is constrained by the Spirit or led by the Spirit. We know that whether he moves or whether he stays is because he's listening to the Spirit and doing what the Spirit has to say. And that's what he's saying now. He is not saying, I know that there's a great work opening up for me in Jerusalem, and all the countrymen, all of our countrymen, they'll come to Christ and it'll be a great thing. I'm going because everyone's going to turn to Christ. That's not what he says. He actually says, I know that I am staring down the face of a lot of trouble, and I'm doing it anyway. I was talking to somebody last night, and they were talking about the end of life. Well, let me back up. Let me say it this way. C.S. Lewis in Screwtape Letters, he's writing to the story. If you haven't read that book, the book is supposed to be from a senior demon to a junior demon about how to tempt people. Okay, so it's a really interesting book, a lot of very interesting ideas. But one of the ideas that the senior demon is upset with the junior demon as he says, look, I got your last letter and you seem so excited that these humans are fighting a war again. And you know that we're going to really get to enjoy all the death and carnage, but you need to recognize something, that as demons, we would really rather people not face their mortality at all. That one of the worst things that happens in a war is that young men recognize they're going to die and they have to think about that. And that's really bad for us as demons, because if they think about how they're going to die, they might think about how they're living. And so when I read that as a young person, I think I was in college when I read that book, that really shaped me. That really made me think and say, well, you know, really, do I consider that I'm not going to live forever? We are all going to die. I was talking to somebody last night, and he said he was talking to a man that was had terminal cancer. It was down to just the last few days, and right before he passed away, he went to him and he said, "What can I pray for you about?" And he said, "Pray that I would have courage," which I thought was interesting. We sang about courage tonight. Let courage rise with danger. And this person I was talking to said that this man that's passing away is one of the most courageous people I've ever met. He has no fear of anything. Why would he ask for a prayer for courage? And the answer is because he's facing the end, and it's frightening. Paul is able to stare directly into the end and say he knows it's coming and still serve God. I am constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. I think sometimes in Christian ministry, we won't continue if we think we might lose air conditioning. Everything has to be soft and easy. And we have to only do things that are pushing where everyone is happy and things are wonderful. And Paul is able to say, guys, I won't ever see you again. And I know that I'm leaving from a good place to go to a hard place. And then he tells us how he's able to do it. Verse 24, but I do not account my life of any value or as precious to myself. There's a great deal of talk in today's world about self-esteem. That for good mental health, we need to esteem ourselves highly. That's what that means, right? We need to think well of ourselves. What is Paul's self-esteem? I do not consider my life precious. What has happened is Paul has learned where his worth comes from. And his worth comes from serving Christ. What makes us valuable is that God loves us. So I don't have to walk around trying to drum up good thoughts and positive thoughts for myself. And you don't either. Real self-esteem, or at least, and it's kind of funny, you know what? The world is not wanting self-esteem on its end. It's wanting people who are not afraid to live. And that's true. There are a lot of people who are scared to live. You know what will help you not be afraid to live? Is to recognize that your next breath belongs to God. And if God chooses to take it, that's okay too. And that's where Paul got to. And I don't know how he manages to live day in and day out in that state. There are times where I think I'm there. And then I wake up the next morning and I am not there. And I have to work through it. And what do you see Paul saying? Well, Paul says that I do not account my life of any value nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course in the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus. That's what pushed Paul to everything. He said, the Holy Spirit's telling me to go, and I'm understanding that I'm going to be imprisoned and think it's going to be bad, but even so, I'm going because God has told me to, and I do what my Lord tells me to do. Verse 26 is a fascinating verse to me. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all. Paul made it sound as if preaching the gospel was not only something he did for others, it was also something that he did for himself. God told Ezekiel the same thing. He told Ezekiel, when I give you a message, you deliver the message. I have made you, anyone know the term? A watchman on the wall. And when I warn you that there is trouble coming and you don't warn the people, then you will be held accountable that you knew and you didn't tell. But I know that I have sent you to a hard-headed people and they won't listen to you. So he actually walks through all the scenarios. Here's what could happen. You could warn them and they could listen, in which case I would save them. Or you can warn them and they will not listen, in which case I will judge them, but you will be spared. Or you can not warn them. I will judge them for their sins, but you also will be judged because you didn't listen. And that's Old Testament. It's really easy for us to say, well, that was before Christ died for our sins. And we're not talking about whether Ezekiel is in heaven or hell based off of whether he spoke or not. But obeying Christ, or obeying what the Lord said, was important. And what Paul says here in the New Testament is, I was given a job by God to do, and you can testify against me. Did I do my job? I am innocent of your blood. I did everything I could to tell you the truth. Now, what you do with it is your business. Wow. Because he goes on to say some pretty tough things. And I'll get to that in just a second. Verse 27, I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. When I was confident that the Lord was calling me to Laurel Bank, immediately my mind came to, it is my goal, if God is willing, that I get to preach through the entire counsel of God. And I have my notes. I'm not accidentally just kind of thrashing around, but I am doing what I can to present to you the full counsel of God. And I think it's important. Paul did too. He said, I did not hold back from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Matter of fact, I almost wonder if when they came to Troas, and Paul is in there in Troas, and we read that he's preaching all the way to dawn, if he doesn't have just a few more things he thinks he needs to finish. My goal was to preach the whole counsel of God, and there's this section I haven't got to. So hang on, we got to get to the end of it. I remember listening to David Platt going to China. He talks about when he got to China, a bunch of farmers came in from the village. It was a small, kind of a secret church, and they were hiding there, or at least it wasn't broadcast. They were there, and he went through... I can't remember. I believe it was a portion of Genesis. He finished his lesson, and they said, well, what happens next? And he said, well, we need to stop and eat, don't we? And they said, well, not really. Let's keep going. And so he preached through all of Genesis. And they said, well, what happens next? And what ended up happening is I think he went through the whole... Jana, can you... What was it? In 3 days' time, he did a survey of most of the Old Testament. These farmers let their fields just do what they're going to do, and they stayed in there, stopping only to eat for 3 days. That is a hunger. And what David Platt learned from that when he came back to the U.S. and came back to his church, and again, you hit the hour mark, and everyone looks at their watch and says, well, boy, he really mistimed this. We're gonna have to wait longer. And actually, that's what moved David Platt to do three-hour Bible studies that he does twice a year, once a year. A six-hour Bible study that he calls Secret Church. It's based off of that. It's a very in-depth study. We've participated in some of those, and they are intense. He brings his outline, and his outline is, what, 100 pages of just his fill-in-the-blank notes, and it's just as fast as he can talk for 6 hours. There is a hunger. Anyway, the point is that Paul thought it was important to preach the whole counsel of God. And then he moves on to verse 28. Therefore, I testify you this day, I'm sorry, verse 28, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore, be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease, night or day, to admonish everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me. In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Excuse me. So what is his message? First off, again, if you notice who he's talking to, these are the overseers of the city of Ephesus. These are the pastors, the leaders of the church. And he says, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. The first item of business that he says is to make sure you yourselves are following Christ. I think that's a warning. Don't think that you are so high that you can't fall. It's a warning to me. As an overseer of this body, I should not think that I'm above reproach. That's why I am so thankful. It doesn't happen a lot, but I'm so thankful when someone comes to me afterwards and says, I'm not sure about this. Is that really what Scripture says? I need that. I need to recognize that I am not the authority. This is the authority. And I'm under this authority just like everyone else is. And Paul says, pay special attention to yourselves. That's how he starts. And then he adds, and the flock. I appreciate it. I know a lot of you pray a lot for me, and I appreciate that. That I need to be studying Scripture and listening to others teaching me. I was telling somebody the other day that I try to put myself in places where I am not the person in charge. Because I'm in charge in the classroom. I'm in charge at church and I'm in charge at home. If I'm not careful, I'll get to a place where I'm always in charge all the time. And I don't know that's healthy for me. So if you see me on a committee wanting to serve as a committee member and not the committee leader, I need that sometimes to not be the one in charge. It's how I am paying attention to myself to make sure I don't fall. And also to the church leaders, he said, and make sure the church is doing okay. Pay attention. Don't get lazy. And he even warns what's going to happen. I know, it's not a question of if, it's a question is when. I know after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. That is terrifying. Paul is saying, my ministry here is gone, and you guys watch out, because I know when I leave, there's going to be attacks. Fierce wolves. Remember what Jesus had to say? Who are the wolves? They're the ones who come in. They look okay on the outside. They're dressed with sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. And he warns, you'll be able to tell them by your fruit. And Paul is continuing that teaching and saying, watch out. They're going to come in, and what are they going to do? They're going to lead astray the disciples. They're going to pull them apart. But that's not the worst part of this admonition. The worst part of this admonition, I think, is the next. Verse 30, and among your own selves, and from among your own selves will arise men. That really gives me the chills. Paul is talking to the pastors that he has been discipling, the ones that he has poured his life into, the ones that he is trusted with. And tradition tells us that in a lot of these places, Ephesus is one of them, that it was Paul who ordained and set up the leadership of the church. He helped them establish who was overseers and who weren't. And he's talking to that group of men that he knows very well. And he says, I even know that some of you are going to turn aside. Oh my goodness, that is hard teaching. What's going to happen is these men will arise speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Well, what do we do? Well, let's do what Paul tells us to do. Verse 31, therefore, be alert. Pay attention. Don't go to sleep. Isn't that so much of what Jesus said? Stay awake, be alert, be watching. The natural tendency of man is to go to sleep. We've got to fight it. We've got to stay alert. Remembering that for 3 years, I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. I think what he's telling the leadership is, you do what I did. While I was here, I was alert. Night and day, I was caring for the people. And when someone began to step out of line, I didn't let it go. I admonished them. Matter of fact, the way he says this helps us understand how this is supposed to happen. This is one of the hardest things to do, how to encourage while admonishing. I said I would get back to this. When Luke talks about Paul's job and what Paul did as he traveled from place to place, Luke says, and Paul did a great deal of encouraging. He encouraged this group, and he went through there encouraging everyone. Paul, he says, I had to admonish you. How can admonishing be an encouragement if it's done with tears? When we were studying prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, there's so much of the prophecies that are such dire warnings about what's going to happen. I would have hated to have Jeremiah's job, to walk around that beautiful temple and say, this building will be destroyed and burned with fire. You guys are going to die. We're going to starve. Life will be bad. I would have hated that job. I know that there are some who love doing that. Some of my first evangelical conversations after I had left home were in college, talking to very non-Christian people. One guy that I was talking to, I think he was the president of the UF Atheist Club, I think. I mean, they didn't like God. But we both agreed that the street preacher in the plaza was not saying good things. And they have shirts, and you can see there's tons of stuff. And I'm not here to bash other people. I don't know that that's necessarily what I'm supposed to be doing. But let me just say that when you walk down and you hear, I'll say it this way. I would go to the Baptist Center where we would gather for lunch and to play ping pong and that kind of stuff. And there were literally girls that were crying. Well, what's wrong? Well, I walked through square and the man said I was a prostitute because he could see my ankles, and on and on and on and on goes. And I remember as we had a lengthy discussion one time about, well, you know, what that guy was saying. You're not a prostitute if your ankles were showing, but a lot of what he was saying is, look, if you're sleeping around, you're sinning and you deserve hell. Is that a wrong message? No. No, that's the right message. What was wrong? I think the delivery was what was wrong. You don't read Isaiah and Jeremiah and them standing up there with angry faces basically saying, I hate you because you've done bad things. What do you see Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel doing? Standing up there and said, you've done bad things and God is judging you, but turn now. And they say it with tears. Jeremiah is known as the weeping prophet. He did not love the judgment that was coming. He recognized that it needed to come, and he was faithful to proclaim it. But he wept over the judgment that was coming. Paul, I think, was a hard person. If you stepped outside of what Scripture says, Paul doesn't let it go. That's why the Jews were trying to kill him everywhere he went, is because they were standing outside of Christ and he wasn't willing to back down. But he did it with tears. And that teaches us something. As leaders, absolutely we have to stand on the Word of God. But never let us get to the place where we lose our tears as we do it. That we should, Paul is looking at the people that are going to rip his church apart. I know from among you will rise up wolves who will say twisted things and gather people after yourselves. Therefore, the rest of you, pay attention. Admonish with tears night and day. I have had to do, praise the Lord, at Laurel Bank, very little admonishment. Matter of fact, I don't know that I've done much at all. Praise God. My prayer is, when tough conversations, that's not true, there have been some times. When they come, may they always come with tears. Verse 32, and now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. That is the good news. Paul doesn't say, listen, if you fall asleep, this work will fall on its head and God's name will not be in Ephesus anymore. He says, I know there's wolves coming, but I commend you to God. God is the one who is in charge. And to the grace, the word of his grace. I commend you to the word of his grace. Why? Because it builds you up. What Paul's saying is, yeah, I know there's people coming, but even though they come, God's word will prevail. I have commended you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you the inheritance among those who are sanctified. Take courage. Wolves or not, God is in control. He's in charge. And this is a good message to us, that in all that we do, never forget the grace of God. I was thinking about that. So many churches we know have decided that their name should be called Grace. And of all the names to choose for a church, I think that is a wonderful name, because it's a declaration of what God has done. From beginning to end, God has been good to us. He's giving us his word. He's given us an inheritance. He's holding us until that time. He will present us with the others, mature and complete. Hold on to the grace of God. Verse 33, I coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. You yourselves know that these hands ministered to my necessities and to those who were with me. In all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak. And remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. I think he's giving us a warning. We can study, we'll get to that other time. We have already looked at false prophets, and one of the first thing you see with people who are teaching the gospel falsely is a desire for money. The two of them seem to go very quickly together, that as you begin to wander from God's word, you almost always start wandering and wanting stuff. And I think Paul is telling the Ephesian elders, and Paul was a tent maker. He made his own way. I don't think all of these Ephesian elders that were there were that in that boat. In other words, it's likely that Paul, as a, if you will, a bivocational minister, is talking to full-time ministers in Ephesus, the overseers. And he's telling them, look, make sure that you don't let greed become a thing. I didn't covet other people's stuff, their gold or their silver or their clothes. And I worked hard, and I did it to help the weak. That's interesting. He could have said to help the poor. And that would make more sense, right? I'm working hard and I'm saving money, and the reason I'm doing that is to help the poor. That isn't what he said. Why do you think he said to help the weak? I guarantee you, you have talked to people who don't like church because it's just a way to collect money. Some of those are good-meaning people, but quite frankly, they're weak if they think that the church is about collecting a paycheck. And so Paul says, I set aside my paycheck so that no one thought that that's what I was doing. It's a good message. And he also says it's more blessed to give than to receive. I liked being on the giving end. I mentioned this morning that y'all gave us birthday money so that I could go out to eat with my family. And it is blessed to receive. Love getting things from you. And it shows your appreciation. And I think it's wonderful. But also, let me give sometimes. Because just like Paul said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And I'm thankful for the way that you give. You as a church show this over and over and over again. And I'm thankful for that. It's more blessed to give than to receive. And then he did one more thing. Verse 36, and when he said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. Paul's last words with the Ephesians were not to the Ephesians, but were together with the Ephesians to God. That's powerful. After all these 3 years of being with them, and he's never going to see them again, he gives his last message, his charge to the leaders of the church. And what did he want the last time for them to remember being together? Is that together they prayed. What's the message to us as the church? Prayer's kind of important. I don't think I could say that any more understated. It is our everything. Verse 37, and there was much weeping on the part of all. They embraced Paul and kissed him, and being sorrowful most of all because of the word that he had spoken, that they would not see his face again, and they accompanied him to the ship. And that's the end. That's the end of Paul's time with the Ephesians. What we see in that last little bit, that Paul, as a spiritual leader, as a father in some ways to the Ephesian church, was loved by the church. They weren't just going to miss his teaching. They were going to miss him. I think that speaks to what the church is supposed to look like. And they know, they knew. When Paul said, you're not going to see my face again, he means on this earth, there's coming a time where we'll see his face. We'll behold Christ face to face. But they cared for Paul. And that says something about his ministry. So what do we do with this? This morning I mentioned that all of us as believers are leaders. None of us are called to... I do not believe that God has ever said, okay, after you get saved, don't be any more sanctified than you were when you got saved. Just sit in the back and you just stay where you are. God has always called us to give our all. So as we look at this, it's hard for me to say, and this is the stuff for me to do, and this is the stuff for you to do. I don't think of it that way. It's all for us to do. Paul warns that it's possible to walk away. Therefore, be careful and alert. Watch. I'm not talking about, that was not a statement that, is it possible to lose your salvation? Okay, so that's not what I was saying. What I was saying is that Paul looked at that group of people and said, some of you people are going to be wolves. Therefore, be alert and pay attention. Okay? So, my message to you is the same. Be alert. Pay attention. Don't get distracted. Stay focused. Here's an idea. When someone needs to be admonished, admonish them with tears. But don't forget, Paul says, God has this. I commend you to God and to the word of his grace. We are held by him. Not by Paul's good teaching, not by my good teaching or bad teaching or average teaching or whatever. It's not held by any of that. We're held by the grace of the word of God. That's how we stand. May we serve him faithfully in all that we do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your love for us. Lord, we don't deserve to be held in your hand the way we're held. And thank you that you don't hold us because of our good works, because that would never stand up. But you hold us according to your grace, so that no one will boast. Thank you for Paul's legacy, for seeing how hard he worked and how he saw his life. And Lord, I pray that you would help each of us to live that way. Give us courage when times are tough and things are scary. May our eyes be focused on you and on what you have called us to do, and help us to be faithful to walk. And Lord, all of that we've said tonight is hinging on being able to hear your Spirit to do what you've called us to do. I pray that you would guide us as a church to know what it is you're calling us to do it with all of our hearts. Lord, if there's anyone here tonight that doesn't know you, pray that you would speak to their heart, that you would draw them to yourself, that they would see repentance and faith in Christ Jesus. Be exalted in us, Lord, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing a hymn of invitation.
Number 308. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry, while on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Throne of mercy, find a sweet relief. Kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. By.
Amen. I hope you have been encouraged today as we've worshiped the Lord. We're going to do something as we end. We're gonna sing to Mary Lee Isley. I think Patrick's calling her. We're gonna sing "I'll Fly Away." So give us just a second to see if we can get her on the phone and get her patched in. Yesterday was her birthday, so maybe we can tell her happy birthday too.
ready.
I don't think that she's seeing us. It's going to be on speakerphone, right? Okay, yep. She can't see us. She can hear the congregation.
When the shadows of this life have grown.